Are You Real? Episode 60.
Welcome to Are You Real? Finding the Authentic You, the podcast that focuses on Christians that are active in everyday life. Join in as we speak to everyone from successful business owners to educators to athletes about their faith and how it helps them reach out and revolutionize those around them to do the same. And now get ready to roar with your host, the voice of manifestation, John Fuller.
Welcome to Are You Real? John B. Fuller here, and I am super excited. Before we jump into today's show, I want to tell you about something that I found that I'm really excited for that I want to share with you guys. Recently, I just met a guy by the name of Frank Viola. He is a Wall Street Journal best-selling author. We are going to be shooting a show with him here probably in the next month. And what I'm super excited about is he has a course that we have teamed up with him and his company that we are promoting. It is becoming to learn how to be a best-selling author, a blogger, how to write, all those things. So he has come up with a course called the buzzseminar.com/Fuller. We're going to be sticking it on our website for you guys to check out. But here's the excitement. Besides the fact that he himself, Frank Viola, has written 12 books, he's a best-selling author. In this course, he's also getting help from people like Mike Merrill, which I think I'm totally hacking his name. I apologize. He helped make The Shack a best-selling best author. And then also, this is what I'm super excited about. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Ray Edwards. He's a copywriter. He has a podcast. I listen to him every week. Yes, believe it or not, I listen to other people. The guy is phenomenal. Love his show. It's about entrepreneurialism. You got Jeff Goins helping here. So anyways, check this out. We are going to have him here in the next couple weeks. It's going to be phenomenal. But here's the deal. If you buy this course, if you're interested in owning or running a business, you want to blog, you want to write a book, any of that, I highly recommend buy his course. But here's the best part. If you buy his course and you decide to send me an email after you buy it, I'm going to send you my book that's coming out here shortly for free. That's right. I'm going to send it to you for free. So if you buy Frank's course to help you either expand your business, help with your website, blog, any of that, I'm going to send you my book for free when it comes out just to say thank you for supporting Frank. So anyways, guys, super excited today. Can't wait to jump in the show. Here we go. Hey, Roar Nation, John Fuller here, and I am super excited. So check this out. Past guests, we have done authors, I've had coaches, I've had speakers, we've had all kinds of different people on here, which I love. That's the whole purpose of the show. But this one is totally different than what you guys are normally used to. We are going to talk to an image style consultant. So for those of you out there that have fashion problems and maybe nobody has told you you do, this is the person that you're going to need to talk to. And this is why I'm excited. And this sounds funny, but I love clothes. I love shopping with my wife and my girls to a certain extent. They can actually shop till we drop, and I kid you not. But so this is going to be fun, guys. I cannot wait to get plugged in. So totally overdue. Time to jump into it. Ashley, are you ready to jump into this?
John, I am coming in hot.
Come on. Okay. So just so I don't totally jack this up, I believe you said it's Ashley Boucher. Is that correct?
That is correct.
All right. So let's do it. So Ashley is the founder of Art of Style Image Consulting. She works nationwide with clients on how to curate a wardrobe that supports their day-to-day lives. She provides excitement and simplicity in getting dressed. Ashley launched Art of Style in 2014, and it was not until she laid her life down at the feet of Jesus that she fully encompassed what it meant to use her gifts, serving as a temple for the Lord and showing people how to walk in their truest self, rocking their suit of armor. All right, Ashley, let's jump into this, girl. I want to hear more about your passion for Jesus. I cannot wait to jump into your business and tell me how those intertwine, girl.
Yeah, so it's a really interesting path that I walked to get here. I am a girl who does not come from a family of fashion. I'm someone who feels just as comfortable skating on my longboard as I do shopping in Neiman Marcus. so when I was growing up, it was always about, you know, I reading these fashion magazines, but not understanding, you know, how can I go to Old Navy and TJ Maxx? And, you know, I've always been like a normal person, never like a supermodel or anything. And just how do I recreate these looks for myself? And, you know, what does that even look like in a career? And so I, you know, all I wanted to do was go to fashion school. There was things my whole life leading up to it where it was just, you know, fashion was a very big part of my life. And I would sit in first period every day and like write down, you know, exactly what I was wearing to school. And, you know, my parents were amazing. I have, you know, the best family, and they were just like, you need to go and experience university. Like, fashion school is absolutely not an option. And so from that, yeah. And, you know, and I understand, like, again, they do not, I have like a very normal, I grew up outside of Houston. Like, you know, we walked to church as a family. Like, it was very normal lifestyle. And so to go into the fashion industry, I understand, can be like very different for parents. And so I went to 2 years at university, and it just was not filling my tank. I was having a lot of fun, but I just didn't feel like I was developing and growing in the areas that I really felt passionate about. And so I found this program through my university, actually, that allowed me to go to Hong Kong and China and study the whole supply chain of the fashion industry there. And they partnered with Fossil and JCPenney, and we got to, you know, spend certain amounts of time just shadowing different places within the industry, but all the way across the world. So here I was, this like 19-year-old girl, like, mom, dad, guess what? I'm going to move to Hong Kong and go to the factories and like watch them weave cotton and then see what it turns into. And
yeah. So what was your parents' response to that? Cause I'm trying to, my daughter is totally into fashion. So I'm trying to picture getting a phone call from my oldest telling me that she's off to Hong Kong. I think my wife would have a heart attack, and I would probably be not too. So what was your parents' response to that, thinking you're going to take off?
You know, my parents, I think that moment, they knew how important the industry was to me. And they also knew how, I think, you know, when I came to them with this idea and this concept, I had this whole like presentation put together of like, you know, what we were going to be doing, what I was going to be learning. And I lived in Times Square of Hong Kong in a hotel. And I can remember like having to figure out the time change and like FaceTiming with them. And it was like right when Skype started. This was back in 2011. And so, you know, they were definitely petrified as parents, but it was that first time where they were like, okay, we hear it in her voice. Like, we need to let her spread her wings and we need to do this. And so they drove up to Dallas, or I was going to school at UNT, University of North Texas, right outside of Dallas. And they drove up from Houston and dropped me off at the airport. And I had, you know, my way overpacked bags, and off I was. And it was, I could imagine that it was really probably challenging for them, but they, I think once, I don't know, I'm not a parent, but as a child, you know, I understand that love that my parents have for me, and they just want me to succeed in what makes me happy and like really use my gifts. And so I think it was like a really, I'm the oldest child, so I think it was like their first time to really be tested in that area. And it was a great experience for all of us.
I'm just curious, was that hard going there just speaking English or no? Or what was that like?
Yeah, you know, I actually had a translator with me. So his name was Conan. That was like his American name. They all choose American names. So he was like obsessed with a comedian.
That'd be fun. You just get to make up any name you want. So you just go to a foreign country, just make up any name.
Yeah, but you know, it was amazing. It was really eye-opening. I was with other American students. And so, you know, it wasn't something that we were going through. I wasn't going through it on my own. Like, I was going through it with other students. And it was just, it was my first, I had been overseas before, but just to like, you know, Europe with my family. So it was never like, Asia was a very, very, very different country, especially when we got into the countryside of like mainland China and into the factories. And, you know, it was hard. It was really, it stretched my soul so much, but it also really allowed me to see, you know, what it was about the industry that I love.
Okay. So I'm just curious, and we're going to go into a lot of the other questions that I asked my guests, but I'm just curious, why did it stretch you?
I think because it was my first time, you know, when I was there, the program did a really good job. Like, we were in the factories and, you know, yes, you were only able to communicate with people if you had your translator right by you. And, you know, we were going through, we were seeing the living quarters, you know, seeing their everyday lifestyle of clothing that we just as Americans put on our back with, you know, not much two thoughts into it. And it's just like, oh, this is clean. Like, let's wear this today. This makes me feel good. Okay, I've got a meeting, XYZ. And to see, like, at each and every step that just that one shirt takes to get it onto a sales floor and, like, the amount of hands that touch it and the process that goes into it before. And then, like, the living conditions aside from that, it's just, it's a very different culture than what I had ever been exposed to before in any form of travel.
Tell me about that a little bit, because I'm just curious. What is, like, the living condition? So when I think of it, I think of, like, a sweatshop, and I think of, like, just all these people just in a sardine can of a building just working their butts off for low wages. So, yeah, give me a little bit of a image of that, because I don't know if I'm ever going to China to go to a factory. So just tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, well, so, you know, it's really interesting because I was just recently in India, and I was able to see a lot of their handmade artisans. And it's very different in comparison to what I saw in China. And, you know, you walk into these, yes, they are sweatshops, and you go in and it's, you know, concrete floors or tile floors. There's no paintings or no pictures on the wall. Like, you know, it's almost like you're just in a school cafeteria, but minus the children's artwork. And it's just floors and floors and floors of it. And most people that work there live on the property grounds, and they live in these apartments that, you know, I'm 5'7", and so my wingspan is not very large, and I could touch if I put my arms out in a T from side to side, and they would have 4 to 6 people sleeping in one of those rooms in just like bunk beds that were like bamboo. And, you know, their shower is also like, you know, their restroom, and it's their way of life. You know, they send their monies home to their family. And so a lot, you know, I'm excited because a lot of, you know, what my business is stepping into, or not a lot of it, but a main part of it, is uplifting the artisan crafts that still survive today. Like going to India and seeing like the handmade goods and just like the passion and the spirit and the life that's poured into something that's not touched by a machine is so, it's just so soul like enriching than, you know, literally a line of people where it's like, I have this one picture that I'll have to share it with you. And I hope maybe you can put it on your website or something, but it's this picture I took of this woman. And I always joke that it's like, she's got 99 problems, but a shirt ain't one, because it's literally like, I mean, probably 3 meters high of just these plaid shirts stacked up, and they're like not organized stacked. It's like a pile. And her job was to sew on the buttons. And that was it. That was her job. That's what she did every single day. And that was that, you know.
Did you get to talk to any of these people?
No, we spoke with, like, we would have to go to the meetings with like the owners of the factories and things like that to talk about, you know, distribution. And, you know, we went to the shipping yards where things were distributed out. Like, when I say we studied the supply chain, we literally every single detail of the supply chain was what we stepped into. And so
that'd be fun.
It was really fun.
I mean, it sounds cheesy, I guess, from a business sense. I had a business, or I worked with a guy that's what I had to do. I imported building materials from all over the world. So I was on one part of the supply chain. So it was really cool bringing stuff in. You get to meet people from all over the world and stuff. But for what you got to do, though, I think would be amazing, because you get to see it from all aspects. Is that, and get to study how it works too. So let me ask you this. How did seeing all that, because that's not what you do. I mean, you're helping people design what you call a suit of armor for them. How did that help you, though, understanding that and the background aspect of your business? How has that helped you in what you do?
So with my business, what I do is I really go into people's homes, or I'll go into a corporation, and I just really dive into the soul and the heartbeat of like how it is that, you know, that one individual or that business is working. And I, you know, look at the artwork, I look at who they are, what makes them tick, what their day-to-day life is like. Are they a mom that's, you know, rushing to volleyball practice, like after she's been, you know, in an office all day? Or, you know, is it someone who's in consulting that's on and off planes? And but prior to going to Asia and really looking at the supply chain, fashion for me was like, oh my gosh, I've saved up a bunch of babysitting money. Like, let's go to Old Navy and buy every single like colored pair of jeans that they have, or like the fashion magazines that I was, you know, striving. I'm going to show my age here, but striving to look like the Olsen twins or something like that. And so when I was, you know, took it that one step further of even beyond like the textbooks and studying, you know, merchandising at my university before I was going, it wasn't until like I saw the concept and like the life that went into a garment that it just kind of shook something up inside of me. And then I was able, when I was there, I really, what I enjoyed and really just found so fascinating was the concept of how they create this, like, you know, story with each piece to then market it to the, you know, consumer. And so from that, I had knew of a personal shopper in Dallas. And so when I was after Asia, I went to international business school for like a study abroad program in Italy. And when I was finishing up there, I was like, okay, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, like, where should I go? New York is just very intense for me. LA was just not really like my scene. And so I was like, okay, Dallas is centrally located. You know, there's a good amount of liquid income there. I knew of a personal shopper in Dallas that I couldn't get a job with her immediately, but I got a job at a store.
So wait, time out. Explain it. I know what a personal shopper is, but maybe for some of our listeners that don't, it's a job. Explain what a personal, I need a personal shopper, but anyways, tell us what personal shopper is, what they do.
Yeah. So a personal shopper is someone who comes in agreement on a budget for you, and then they take your credit card information and go to a store and they go shopping for you. Or in my case, I do have relationships with stores in Dallas. And so I bring all the clothes on approval to my clients' homes, and I just set up like a little boutique in their house, and I have like my rolling rod and lay out all the clothes. And so then we're able to say, you know, oh, this would work really well with that top that you got last season that you've never worn, but you bought it because you loved it, or it put you in a good mood. But you know, we just create that strong wardrobe that doesn't have an abundance of overflow. And, you know, it really works for their lifestyle. So a personal shopper kind of does your dirty work for you, keeps you at your budget. And then every time you open your wardrobe, you're like, oh my gosh, everything has purpose. I always have something to wear. And I'm not just rushing out to buy something because that, you know, 911 happened and you're like, I have a meeting with the boss tomorrow.
Okay. So we're going to back up a little bit. I want to ask you this. Over the years, as you started, you talked a little bit about in high school and things like that. Did you just know, like, you deep down inside, like, this is what I'm going to do because I always think about it? It was just always on your mind?
I always, fashion was my thing. It was, you know, my favorite Christmas was a like mahogany redwood wardrobe closet that Santa brought me for, you know, my American Girl dolls clothes with like all matching hangers. And I would just sit for hours and hours, and, you know, getting best dressed was like always my thing. And
that was your goal,
like,
huh?
My goal for the year. Yeah. And so did I ever know that personal shopping was a thing until I started looking into it? Absolutely not. I used to play this game with friends and like my parents' friends and be like, ask me anywhere on the store directory at the mall where any store is and I can tell you where it is. And like, I was just always shopping and like always playing dress up with people's, you know, with all my mom's friends. My mom was a school teacher. So, you know, it's funny because all of the pain and all of like that darkness and the nitty gritty that I know we're going to get into because of listening to your other podcast, like the common thread, the thing that was never taken away was just that passion for, you know, helping others and discovering their beauty and just like the way that the Lord sees them and the way that he's provided me to do that is, you know, through shopping for them and like getting clothes that make them feel good and that makes sense to them as an individual and their lifestyle. And it was something that, you know, I now looking back and like, oh my gosh, like that was always there. That was always a gift for him. And people ask me all the time, like, do you just walk around and like judge people, like what they, you know,
and come on, Ashley, be honest. I'm curious.
Yeah.
You're like, oh my gosh, that looks terrible. I can't believe they're wearing that.
You know, and of course, like jokingly, if I see my dad when he, bless his heart, like still wears pleated pants, I'm just like, Dad, come on. Like, you're really not doing me justice here. But I don't, you know, that's how I really know that it truly is like my gift from the Lord, because I don't look at someone unless I'm like on the clock and I'm doing it from a place of like, I'm really trying to help them. But I don't just walk down the street and I'm like, oh, honey, here's my business card. Like, give me a phone call. It's really not like that at all. And it's, you know, some people are probably, you know, they roll their eyes when they hear me say that, but it's true. Like, I run around in like, you know, sweats and coconut oil on my face, like the best of them. So for me, like what I do is just really like helping people see themselves in that beauty and feel that confidence and just eliminate that stress and that frustration that so many people start their days with, because they really just have never been taught how to properly dress themselves. And there is such a saturation in our market of just like clothing. It's like, where do you even begin? And I get it. I can look at a pair of pants and I can say, please don't even try those on because it's going to frustrate you. And I can tell you, because of the way that the bias is cut with the pocket, it's not going to work on your body type. And it's like, that's just the way that I think. And so, you know, it's just, it's cool. It's a really, it's really unique, but I love it.
That's exciting. Okay. So what has been an inspirational scripture or success quote that you have used the last couple of years?
So the scripture for me that really just totally transformed my life was 1 Corinthians 6:19. And it's, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. And I came across that scripture, I don't remember exactly when it hit my heart, but it was probably in November of 2016. So really not that long ago. But, you know, that's also another thing that I just, you know, I thank you so much for inviting me on this show, because I'm really, really fresh and really, really raw in this new walk with the Lord. And my world has completely, I mean, I have like been just died and like come back to life. Like, my foundation was shattered and I have rebuilt it with the Holy Spirit, and it has been like the most beautiful year. But that, when that verse hit me, you know, it really broke a lot of those things, just, you know, painful things that we put into our body, whether it's, you know, I have a really intense history with my family of, you know, just health issues. And so I had been ignoring that and just abusing my body in that sense. And then, you know, drugs were a really big problem for me. And then like alcohol consumption and, you know, working in the fashion industry, you're exposed to a lot of things, especially when you are, you know, when I first stepped into my business, I didn't really know who my gifts were meant to serve. It wasn't until, you know, like I said, like in my bio, like laying my life down at the feet of the Lord and saying like, Lord, these gifts are from you. Like, I am so grateful. Now, who do you want me to serve? But up until that, when I started my business, like the people that called me were, you know, very wealthy people. And it was private planes. It was fashion weeks. It was parties. It was resorts in Mexico. And they would fly me just to dress them while I was there.
Now, how old are you? Real quick, and I'll interject in different parts. So And yeah. I remember for pre-interview chat, so you're flying all over the world, getting paid to be in people's private jets, stuff like that. How old are you
at this time? I was 23 years old.
Okay, so let me ask you this, and just truth be told, like, was your head swelling? I mean, I would be for me, and I thank the Lord that I wasn't at that level at 23, because I think I would have thought I was, like, you know, the man. So was that hard? Right. Was that hard?
I wouldn't say my head was swelling, because when I moved to Dallas, I jumped right into work. Like I very quickly got a job with the personal stylist, and I handed her my life on a silver platter. And so I never really had that time to make friends within my community of my age group. I didn't have a community. Thankfully, like, the Lord also brought my, like, soul sister and my best friend from California to Dallas at the same time. And so, you know, whenever I did have a free moment, I had her, and she knew, like, it was more like killing me softly on the inside, because I was having so much fun and people were, like, seeing all these photos of me traveling and, like, seeing that, you know, social media presence of just, like, this glamour of, like, oh my gosh, Ashley's at Jimmy Choo. Now she's in Mexico. And, like, now she's on a, you know, I was at, like, a Buddhist retreat colony in, you know, Santa Fe. And it was just like, my life was crazy. And so for me, it was more just draining. But it was a slow, slow, slow process.
Now, you weren't walking with the Lord at this time. Is that right? Yes, no, maybe.
I'll say I was a believer. I was a Christian. You know, I was raised in the Methodist church, but I didn't understand what it meant to live for the Lord.
Okay, so is it fair to say you knew of God, but you didn't, like, know him, like, you didn't have this in-depth relationship with him and the Holy Spirit?
Totally. Okay. Exactly.
Okay, yeah, those are two totally different things, because until you have that transformation, and we all have, I remember being at that point myself, but people would be like, oh yeah, I know Jesus, and I'm like, yeah, okay, yeah, you know of him, but do you really know him? And that is life transforming. So, okay, take me a little bit from, I'm assuming you're making good money, because you can't be traveling around the country in private jets. So you're making good money, we're flying around, you're helping people out, you're spiritually getting drained. Take mm-hmm. me to, at this point, is it safe to say you're kind of at a high point in your business?
In my business, definitely at a high point. I had gotten into some clients, though, that were very much so kind of taking all of my time. So I was starting to work with companies like Pepsi, Deloitte, Facebook, and then I was working for, you know, some individual clients in Dallas that were taking more of my time just because of the travel than I was allowing it with, like, those corporations that were really building up my business and allowing me to touch a platform of people that necessarily needed and were learning from my expertise, but they weren't able to afford my services. And so the company would then hire me to come in and do, like, a little presentation on, like, this is how you build a wardrobe, this is what you need to know, this is how you know shop, you know, X, Y, and Z. But then, you know, I really got involved with my clients that were, you know, it was because it was luxurious. It was fun. It was glamorous. Like, I was 20 at this time, 24 years old. So in 2015, I guess 2015. It was the May of 2015. And I now looking back, I'm like, okay, that was the Lord. But at that time, I didn't have that intimacy with him. And I put a halt on all of those major clients. I put a halt on that lifestyle. You know, I knew that I was totally wiped out, and, you know, my tank was empty. I didn't feel like I was utilizing my gifts. I just felt like I was, you know, a travel companion for these people, and then, like, someone that they could play dress up with. And so that was a big deal for me to, like, make that decision to really walk away from that world. And it was scary, because that's where, like, 90% of my income was coming at the time.
Well, hold on real quick, though. I want to hit on this, because I remember from us talking at this point, I don't know if it's safe to say, are you into drugs? You're kind of like, what's going on there? Because I know you have some great low points, man, that are hilarious.
Yeah. So actually, you know, smoking like pot was something that was just always, it was my release. It was my numbing device. It was after I was out, you know, with these clients and at these parties and like doing these things, I would come home and I would do yoga and I would smoke a bowl and go to bed. And so that was like always there. I got into that like right when I, like heavily when I moved to Dallas, just because of a guy I was dating at the time. And then at that time in May, when I walked away from my clients, I met a guy and he wasn't at the time. Ironically enough, he moved to Dallas to open up a church. And then something happened and I still don't know what it was, but he then got in when we were, it was briefly after we became friends. He started selling marijuana, but in like a wax form. And so it was just definitely more intense. And he moved in with me at one point, and that brought me to my breaking point. And, you know, and it wasn't because of him. And that's really where I've accepted. And what the Lord has really shown me is that, you know, a lot of things happened at that time. I blew through my savings. And so, you know, because of like these secrets and these lies that I was keeping for him, you know, I was pushing away my best friend. I was pushing away my family. You know, I started having, you know, severe anxiety attacks, and I never knew like what that meant, but it's like, oh no, when it comes up your body and it starts creeping up your legs. And, you know, I would be flying to DC to work with clients, and then I would come back and there would be like a note from, you know, my friend who was living with me, and just, we had gotten a dog together, and, you know, we weren't like in a relationship as like, you know, intimately, but we were best friends. And it completely consumed me. And, you know, it was a really, really dark place. But in that time, you know, I just started to break. And all I knew to do was just walk the Katy Trail, which is like a trail in Dallas. And I would just look at the leaves and I would be like, Lord, I know that you made those leaves. Like, I believe that you made me. Like, what do I do? Like, what am I doing? Like, what's going on? And so I have like my hairdresser, who I'm totally in love with, him and his wife and their kids. And he'd been telling me for a few years, like ever since I started, when I moved to Dallas and started seeing him, like, hey, you need to come to the upper room. Like, you, I think you would really enjoy my church. And I was like, yeah. Okay, whatever. He was like, yeah, no, I think you would love it. Like, people dance there, you know, the Holy Spirit rocks. And I just like, I don't know. I wasn't looking for it.
Yeah.
That.
Coming from a Methodist background, that had to be a totally different environment for you.
Yeah, it was very different. And so one Saturday, I don't even know what it was that just clicked. And I was like, one of the things I love about Upper Room is that they have like worship sets throughout the week. So Saturday they have like a morning time set. And so someone will just play worship music. And so I knew my hairdresser was playing that day. So I was like, I'm just going to go listen to him. I'm a big journaler. So I didn't even like own a Bible to like take and read. I'm like, I'm not going to fake it and like go out and buy one or anything. Like, I'm just going to take my journal, like just go sit there. And so I walked in and I didn't cry. Like, I really enjoyed it. And I had this at the end of it, it was like a 2-hour set. Woman came up to me and she laid hands on me. And that was something that I had like never experienced either. Like, you do not touch people at a Methodist church. Like, no, thank you. And so I had this woman come up and she laid hands on me and she just goes, I don't even remember exactly how she said it, but she just was saying like, you are a leader. Like, I just see this like glory that's upon your life, that like you are meant to lead people and you are like such a strong force. And I'm just looking at her like, lady, like, I just smoked a bowl before I came. Like, I am like losing my business. Like, I'm not, like, I haven't spoke to my parents in weeks. Like, my life feels like it's a mess. But she touched this place in my heart of like, I have always been a leader. Like, my entire life, I have been a leader. Like, that's just who I was. That's who I am. Like, I'm strong. And so the fact that she could see that was just, it wrecked me. And I drove home and I started doing yoga and I just laid on the floor of the place I was living at the time. I just started to weep from like the deepest place that I had ever cried from. And it was my first time to like hear the audible voice of the Lord as clear as you and I are speaking now. And he was just, and I just said, God, like, how am I still here? Like, how do I still live in this place? How do I still, you know, whatever, whatever. And he just, as clear as day, goes, because I was always there. You were never alone. And then, of course, like, the waterworks really start to come. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, like, I just heard the Lord. Like, this is crazy. So then from there, you know, that was in April of 2016. So I just hit a year, like, not too long ago. And that's when my life really started to radically change. You know, it took a lot because I was definitely stubborn. Like, I want to lose my dog. Like, was a really big thing that I had with this guy. I, you know, didn't know how to tell him, like, what I was, like, what was going on. And so my birthday is, like, early May. So not long after that, like, you know, actually right after that, I went to Denver, Colorado with him for 420, and we sat front row on Red Rocks Amphitheater and watched a Wu-Tang concert. And I was just like, this is crazy. Like, I really need to, like, change some things in my life.
So did you feel totally, like, so you would have done this in the past and not a big deal. So now, like, you just had this awesome experience with, and then this lady speaks into your life. So now you're at this event, like, just internally, were you just frustrated thinking this just is not working?
I think, honestly, John, frustration probably is not the word I would use to describe it. I felt so confused and so lost. And I was just like, I wasn't taught growing up, like, my father has the most beautiful relationship with the Lord, but it's private. Like, I know, you know, it's always been there. I know he loves the Lord. I know that he has a great faith, but it's private. I going to the Methodist church, like, you know, I did UM Army as a kid, like, mission trips, was in the church choir, but, like, I didn't know what the voice of that was real. I didn't know that God was alive and that he was real and that he can speak into our lives as clear as, like, a conversation would be with you and I. And so I think I was just like, how did I get here? It was like a numbness almost over me of just like, how did I get here? Like, how, like, what do I do? Like, you know, I think numb is probably the best way to describe that weekend. And, you know, it's funny because it was a terrible weekend. Like, him and I got in, like, a crazy gnarly fight where it was just like, oh my gosh, like, this is painful. Like, you know, looking back, I'm like, okay, God was just making it a lot easier for me to, like, severage those ties or, like, cut that relationship. And it took about 4 months or so, like, right after that weekend, May 4th is my birthday, and I went sober, like, completely cold turkey. Like, I wasn't even drinking at the time. And it was funny because him and my best friend and my parents had, like, planned this huge surprise party for my 25th birthday. And I walk in and I'm like, okay, and I'm going sober. Hello, everyone. Like, we can all just set those
surprise
pain down. Yeah. So, you know, that's when I just would start to go every day almost to the upper room, and I would just take my computer. I would work from there, you know. Thankfully, I have, like, a really amazing family who was able, because I had blown through all my savings, and I had worked a little bit amongst that time, but, like, you know, it was not quality work that I was providing my clients. I was very distracted and very just, like, internally shutting down, and, you know, I had all these secrets that I was keeping. And so in October of 2016, there was, like, a 7-day series where the Lord just every single day made it that much one step closer to removing that aspect of my life. And it was really powerful, and it was, you know, it was very intimate, and it was very much so the Lord. You know, it was painful. It was dirty. It was messy. And it broke me free. It broke a lot of chains. And since then, you know, I think one of the most interesting things that I've really learned is that, like, I have now, since that happened in October, have been growing this, like, beautiful relationship with the Lord, and, like, you know, building a community at my church. Right after that happened, I started, you know, making friends at the church, and, you know, I got the opportunity to go to India for a month. That wasn't through my church, but that was, like, through something else. And, you know, all these opportunities started to arise again. And, like, you know, they were very much so pouring into, like, what I felt like, you know, my gifts were, you know, meant for, and I started to understand like who I was meant to serve. And I was getting these projects that, you know, I was not going after. I have never marketed for myself or my business. And so it was just, I know the Lord like bringing these into my life, and it was opening these, you know, new concepts of things in my business that I didn't even know. It was like stretching muscles in my business I didn't even know existed. And I learned, not very quickly, but it took me some time, but I learned that, you know, my perspective on everything in the world has changed. Literally how I live, how I breathe, how I take every step is different now. But it takes twice as long, if not longer, for the people that I come in that I like encounter on a daily basis, for their perspective of me to change, because they're not experiencing that intimacy that I am with the Lord, and like that healing that I am with the Lord. And so, you know, they know this Ashley that they had been around for the last year or so. And even before that, like before, you know, the drugs became a big part of it, it was the partying, and it was the friends, and it was the lifestyle, and it was the glamour. And, you know, I grew up in a family that there was not any problems. Like my sister and I, like, we don't fight. Like I love her, and like my parents are madly in love. Like there's no divorce in my family. Like I didn't have any problems as a child until, you know, I walked out on, like, I became an adult and I started doing things on my own, and I started to, you know, make decisions to dance with the devil. And, you know, so that's as much as, like, you know, people love me and they see that like true, like goodness in me, there was still that rebellion that it's taken time, and it's still a healing process that people are going through. And so I've had to really accept that with grace, that, like, you know, some people like that I've, especially my parents and like my closest friends, you know, like they were really exposed and wounded in that time. And just simply because I was pushing them away, and they loved me so much that pain was there. And so I think, you know, I've had the opportunity to just really share my heart with a few of them and just be like, I'm okay. Like I was, you know, in my lowest of my lows. And this is how I know that just like the fashion industry is like totally me, is that like, when I was crying, like almost every day, I was like, I'm not a crier. Like I'm not supposed to be crying or sad right now. So I started wearing like sparkle on the corner of my tear ducts, like on my eyes. So when I cried, I could cry sparkles, because I was just like, I can't be sad and not be like, you still my sparkly self. Cause I was so used to like putting a mask on to just be like, everything's okay. Yep. Nope. I'm good. Like we're good. Life is perfect. Like,
so Ashley, I want to get into this real quick, cause we're going to go off on rabbit trails, cause your stories are awesome. Okay. So we're going to just hit some quick points for the sake of time, but I want to ask you, you know, you talked about serving, using your gifts and your strengths. So you already knew what they were, but you started like realizing, hey, I need to serve people. God's given me gifts. After you had this encounter with the Lord, what would you, and these are short answers, what do you feel like your biggest strength and gift is, what God's given you?
Yeah, so I would say my biggest strength is just really seeing an individual, like right when I first meet someone, whether it's going to be a friendship or a client relationship, and just seeing them in the beauty that God sees them, you know, just instantly, I just instantly can love on someone. I instantly can pick up on their good, on their passions. And it's a really cool thing. And I think, you know, stepping in, just because of your pre-cliff notes that you beautifully sent to me, you know, one of my hardest things then twists that, because I'm like only seeing the good in people until they really show some ugly. And that's been something that I really had to like balance, because, you know, it's beautiful for my job to be able to like fully just see someone in their like glory that the Lord sees them, and then build them up in that through their clothing. But then like in my personal life, it, you know, it can really hurt.
Yeah. So you really got to pray for discernment and just ask. Yeah. Cause you can see that can be, you can accept people too much to the point where it gets you in trouble, and then you got to get out of it possibly.
Yeah. Discernment is definitely my biggest prayers right now, is what I'm praying for and like asking the Lord to give me, is because that's not something I'm very good at.
I totally get it. Okay. So what is the biggest thing right now that God's stirring inside of you that gets you excited?
I am so excited about him downloading just these ideas into my heart and into my mind and bringing them to fruition with just working with much people on a much larger scale. So, you know, just really being able to pour my services into those that, you know, necessarily can't afford like those one-on-one services, developing platforms in our business that will allow me to like touch those and like still provide my knowledge to them. So that I'm really, really excited about. It's been like really fun. It's been my first time to ever really like and like come up with something on my own, or not on my own, obviously it's, you know, with definitely from God, but it's something that I've had to like sit at my computer and just be like, okay, Lord, like I'm about to hit these keys. Like, tell me what you wanted me to do today. And, you know, just with some projects that he's delivered my way and to some concepts that, you know, it's really cool. It's really fun.
Okay. How do you use, so obviously not all your clients are Christians, and which is beautiful in that. How do you use your gift, that what God's given you, which is fashion, how do you use that to minister, or how do you take opportunity to love on people and share the gospel within what inside of what you do?
You know, it's really intimate when I'm with someone and they're, you know, I'm giving them clothes and dressing them. And so just really leading conversations with them that makes them feel comfortable to really share their heart. And, you know, necessarily if it is me sharing scripture and, you know, presenting it in a way that I'm not like, well, the Bible says this, but I can just kind of talk to them and just like breathe life into them. And then 9 times out of 10, they're going to be like, oh my gosh, like you're so young. How do you like have that wisdom? Or how do you like, wow, you just really like hit my heart there. And then I can always just come and say like, it's Jesus, like, or I actually, like, I just got that from the Bible, or like, I've had, you know, this experience and this experience. So, you know, I'm very raw about it and very open about my beliefs and my Christianity. And I just, and it's something that I definitely did not build my business foundation on from the start. And so now that I've rebuilt my foundation of my company with the Holy Spirit for Jesus and for, you know, that world, like it's something that I very much so make known. And so I've just been excited for continuing forward. As I said, like it's very new for me, but what more people I can touch.
Absolutely.
Awesome. Yeah.
Okay. What has been a recent book or anything that's really impacted you that you'd like to share with our listeners?
Yeah. So one book was by, and I really hope I get the enunciation correct, but it's Subroto Bachi, and that's Subroto, last name Bagchi. And he has this book called Go Kiss the World, and it's an inspirational book to young professionals. And it just, I really took a lot away from it. It's an Indian author, and there's a lot of really good wisdom in that book, and just determination and hard work, and I liked it.
Okay. Normally I would ask about any resource, but what we're going to ask for fashion advice. So what is a, like quick tip that you would give, or something, some type of fashion advice you can give our listeners?
Oh my gosh. You totally just sparked this.
Yeah. I'm sorry, man. I had to do it. It just wouldn't make it for a great show if I didn't put people on the spot.
Yeah. You know what? I think my heart is just really being called to say, be comfortable in who you are and the way that you dress, but be fearless. I mean, if there's something that you know, like my dad and his pleated pants, like I have tried to get him out of those for so long, but he loves them and he feels comfortable in them and he rocks them. So I would just say, like, spend some time really getting to know yourself and getting to know like what you feel awesome in, and then rock it. Like if it's a bright teal t-shirt, you know, I feel like so many people get scared of like wearing certain trends because they just don't feel like they have the right figure, or they aren't confident enough, or, you know, there's just that fear that holds them back. And so that's my favorite part of working with my clients, is when I'm like, no, try that on. Like, trust me, just put it on your body, and then they'll wear it, and it'll just radically change how they, you know, interact with people throughout the day, because there's this like essence of confidence. And that's where I kind of came up with like the suit of armor, because, you know, it's fashion, it's clothes, it's meant to be fun and silly, but our world is very visually based. And If you're wearing something that totally reflects who you are and what you are on the inside, like, it's crazy how it affects you emotionally and mentally and just gets you through your day.
Oh, I love it, man. That's great. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, so for the sake of time, we're going to try to wrap this up, but I do want to ask you this because I never skip this question. If you go back to the younger you, what are you going to tell, what age would you pick, and what advice are you going to give yourself? You can't change what's going to happen, but you can give yourself advice knowing that you're about to go through it. What would you say, and at what age?
I would like to say I would go back to 1920, and I would say align my heart, body, and soul and lay it at the feet of Jesus. I was so focused always on, like, you know, health, and I'm a big yoga person and, like, you know, aligning all of your aura and all of that. But I never understood the concept of just laying your life down for the Lord and living for Him. And so I would just say, you know, connect your mind, your body, your soul, and just lay it down for the Lord.
Amen, man. It's great advice. Okay, so one last thing as we wrap this up. All of us, most of us need fashion advice. Where, and we need your help. So how do we find you and website, all that good stuff, so we can get your help and tell us about it?
Yeah. Okay. So my website is www.artofstyle.com. My email is ashley@artofstyle.com. That's like my personal email. You'll find, if you go to the website, the company email, but I'll just give you guys my personal. And then our Instagram is probably the most, just with being in the fashion industry, the place where we're most active. We do push everything to Facebook, but our Instagram's artofstyle_AOS. And yeah, you know, I would love if anyone reaches out and they've, you know, been listening through this podcast. I do travel all over the U.S. to work with clients and different corporations. So, you know, one thing I really wanted to offer, and just like, you know, I so much am so grateful for this podcast. It's seriously such an honor to be on here. I've loved listening to it. And so just if you do book after hearing me on this beautiful podcast, just mention it. Obviously, I'll know whenever we're talking and you're like, oh, I heard you. But just make it very known. And then a percentage of the invoices are going to go back to pouring in and sowing into your ministry and your podcast.
Oh, wow. Thank you. I've never had anybody tell me that. Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, no, I'm really tithing is something that I've really come to, like, learn a lot about. And I think it's so important, and just sowing into, like, the proper places. And, you know, whenever you thought of that idea, or we talked about, you know, doing something, I just thought, like, okay, what can I do for these listeners? And it was very clear. Like, it didn't take me long to think, like, proceeds need to go back to this ministry, because it is powerful. And, you know, for a long time before I found your podcast, I was listening to a different entrepreneur podcast that did not have, you know, it wasn't like antichrist or anything of that nature, but it did not have the Lord being present and focused. And I just think so many of these entrepreneurs need to have that guidance and need to have that blessing and that peace, that it's okay to, you know, be a Christian and, like, walk it and live it with your business. And, you know, just eliminate that fear of, well, what if someone finds out, you know, they're not a Christian? Like, are they not going to hire me for that job? So, you know, I'm just so excited for what you're doing. And yeah, so, and also the other thing is, anyone that is traveling, or that I would need to travel for, I'm going to waive all travel fees for, and, like, travel expenses. So holler if you need any services, and we do have virtual services that are not on our website. We're about to relaunch in the fall, a whole new platform of, like, really interactive content. And I'm really excited for it. And that's kind of what I was, like, referencing. I felt like when I kind of danced around the answer of, like, what I'm most excited about the Lord's doing, because it's going to be live in the fall. But do this.
When it goes live, I would love to promote it, and we'll tell people about it. We'll shoot we'll do a sponsor spot or something on the podcast, and we'll let everybody know that it's live and to check out a past guest. So that'll be awesome.
Oh, awesome. Thank you so much. But yeah, I'm so thankful, and I love all of my clients, and just, you know, I've worked with seriously anyone and everyone, like anyone from, like, dressing people for the CMAs to, like, you know, in the political party of like the glamorous side. And then I've had parents hire me for their kids that have, you know, really low self-esteem, or they're, you know, they're seeing like these girls on Instagram, like flaunting everything. And they, you know, they want them to have like a style of their own. And so we go and we play at Target and we, you know, have like a really low budget. And so it's really special. It's really fun.
That'll be okay. So let's wrap up with this. What is one piece of parting advice you want to give our listeners, what you've experienced this last year?
You know, I think it was a little of that I said earlier about like when you start to go through a heart transformation and the Lord just really, you know, shakes up your life and you really start to change, just have that grace and that peace for those people around you and that patience that it does take a while for the perception to change, but also just having that peace in yourself and to like really truly believe that every single person on this planet, we're all so unique and we're all so different. And like the Lord has created each one of us for something special. Like, you know, how 1 Corinthians says of us being like the temple for him, like our bodies, we are his temple and each of us have something to give to the world. And so I just think don't be afraid to take risks. Like my family thought I was crazy when I said I was going to shop for people for a living. They still think I'm crazy, but you know, I made it happen for myself and I'm still hustling to make it happen. And so, you know, I don't think fear or anything should stand in the way.
Come on, man. Fear is the love is the opposite of fear. And if Jesus loves us and he's inside of us, we don't need to walk in fear.
Yes. Amen.
Amen to that. All right, Ashley, hold on just a second. Roar Nation, thank you guys so much for joining in. I hope you guys a beautiful story of redemption, of what God can do in our lives, bring us through some hard times, even in the midst of finding who we are, our purpose, what we're called to do. It doesn't matter if you own a business, you work for a business, whatever it is, that God has just placed a gift and talent inside of you, and it is to serve people, to love people, and just to inspire the world around you. So if you have not found that yet, please contact us. We would love to help you. Whatever we can do to serve you, because we here want to see you impact the world. So thank you guys so much. Please jump onto iTunes, rate and review us. It helps the show. And I'm begging you, please share this podcast with a friend. You can just take it, share link on your iTunes, whatever. Send it out to a friend and say, you need to listen to this. It'll change your life. So thank you guys so much. We love you. And remember, be real, be authentic, and be you. God bless.
That's all for this episode of Are You Real? Finding the Authentic You. Be sure to go to rureal.org for your free questionnaire to identify your gifts and talents and how you can use them to help people become leaders and catapult them into their destiny to help others become the leaders of tomorrow. We appreciate you spending your time with us and look forward to helping you reach out and revolutionize next time on Are You Real? Finding the Authentic You.